Welcome all of you to this live program at Orthopedic Principles. Today, our guest of honor is Dr. Arpit Jariwala from Dundee, Scotland. Ms. Jariwala is currently working as consultant, shoulder, elbow, and trauma surgeon in NHS Tayside, Dundee, Scotland. He completed his orthopedic residency in IMS BHU before completing his higher surgical training in Scotland. He gained further experience at Tridington Hospital in the United Kingdom. Ms. Jariwala has been extensively involved in teaching, training, and supervision of research projects for undergraduate, postgraduate, and the MCH Orth Dundee students. He has published more than 40 papers in peer-reviewed journals. Mr. Jariwala has been directly involved in supervision of MCH Orth Dundee students, orthopedic trainees, foundation doctors, and medical students from the University of Dundee. For these contributions, he was recently promoted as honorary clinical reader with the University of Dundee. He also serves as a director in the University Department of Orthopedics and Trauma, and also the director of MCH Orthopedic course, Dundee. If you've noticed, Dr. Jariwala has lectured on a topic on a channel in the past, and today it's my great honor to bring back Dr. Arpit Jariwala for this wonderful live program. Over to you, Dr. Jariwala.
Thank you, Hitesh, and many thanks for having me and giving me the opportunity to share my thoughts on how we manage something which is not straightforward. So as Hitesh kindly introduced me, I work in Ninewells Hospital, which is one of the big trauma centers in Scotland. And if somebody, and this is where we are, about an hour away from Edinburgh, an hour and a half away from Glasgow. It's a lovely city, and most of the people recognize, orthopedic people recognize Dundee as the seat of MCH Orth course, which is running for the last 28 years, and hopefully we'll be celebrating its 30th anniversary soon. With that little introduction, my topic for today is lateral and clavicle fractures. And I think I'm not going to teach you what a lateral and clavicle fracture is, demographics and things. I'm just going to take you through my sort of thought process of how do I deal with these injuries, as they can be sometimes tricky to deal with, and then people start to get into problems. Now, the way I try and keep things very simple, because I do a lot of teaching, and when you're teaching, you need to explain things into simple terms. Otherwise, what happens is that the message doesn't go very clear. So I try and keep things simple so that I can teach and train people accordingly. So the way I divide the lateral and clavicular fractures are undisplaced or displaced. Undisplaced, we know, these at the time of injury, the most of the trauma goes through at the time of injury, and if they're not displaced at that time, it is very rare that they'll displace in a few weeks' time. So normally what I do, I put them in a sling, I ask them to take it easy for the first 3 weeks, see them about say 12 to 14 days or maybe 18 days time, and if that's sort of not moved, I generally get them going, see them back about 6 to 8 weeks' time, and if all is well, discharge them to physiotherapy. So we'll not, this is the standard treatment for the undisplaced ones, and we'll not discuss this in further detail. The ones that we'll discuss today are the displaced fractures. Now, what I have done is from my own sort of thought process and how I decide treatment, I've sort of divided them into simple displaced and the displaced with complexity. And what I find simple is where there's a good bone stock on the lateral end where you can put a good plate on. And the complexity is where either there's comminution or a very small fragment. And again, this is one where you need to make up your mind of what you're going to go, or at least have a plan B in place before you start operating. So what options do we have for treating lateral and clavicle fractures? So the standard treatment used to be the hook plate. You put on hook plate and then let it heal, and then you see them back in 4 to 6 months' time, take the hook plate off, and that is about it. Now we are in a generation where we have sort of contoured, well-contoured plates that are lateral end, which give you good fixation, and now people are more and more using it. Now, is there evidence that the hook plate is better or worse, or the lateral end clavicle plate, which are out now, better? And most of my treatment, or nearly all of my treatment, is evidence-based. So we'll go through some evidence. So if you look at the evidence now, this is a study that looked at 9 clinical trials of nearly 446 patients. And this was a meta-analysis which looked at the benefits and risks with hook plates and lateral and clavicle locking plates. And if you see that the lateral and clavicle locking plates do provide better shoulder function with lesser complication. Similarly, another study which was looking at comparison of the two, locking plate versus hook plate, shows that fewer complications with hook plate. Sorry, fewer complications with the locking plate as compared to the hook plate. If you look at this prospective study, it showed that the stable fixation with a pre-contoured plate got good reunion rates and excellent return of function, and then you don't need to remove these. And I think this is a paper that changed a lot of things, is because it shows that the routine use of hook plate cannot be recommended now with the advent of very good periarticular locking plates. So in the last 10 to 11 years of my upper limb practice, I've not used a single plate, but I've removed many. So my experience of hook plates, again, I see them, they have been done elsewhere, or thankfully my unit has completely taken them off. But we see them from different units, or more often we see them being done in Middle East and Europe, and they come back with hook plates because they were on holiday, they injured themselves, they put a hook plate and they come back. And what I find is that I need to take them off at around 4 to 6 months time. But importantly, what you need to understand is that these patients don't just settle down just after that, because nearly 40% will continue to have shoulder pain and secondary impingement signs. So then you have to start with So normally what I do is, if it's a young patient, I'll get an ultrasound scan just to make sure the cuff is intact and the hook plate is not eroded into the cuff. So that's very, very important. And if the cuff is intact, then I'll go and start with physio. And if that's not helping their shoulder pain, then try an injection. Very seldom I need to do any surgery on them, but still these patients take. So they have waited for 4 to 6 months to get the plate off. And thereafter, they wait another 4 to 6 months to get their shoulder back to where it should be. Now, again, I've seen, this is another patient that was sent to me, which had a periprosthetic fracture. So this was a young lad who was 18, injured his AC joint while doing a motor mountain biking, fell down. He had a hook plate in, I think it was in sub-Saharan desert, where they were doing a rally. And then he came to UK. He was seen by one of my colleagues. He said, just leave it. Well, he was not keen on surgery, so they left it for nearly a year. And then he went back on mountain biking, and this was it. Now, this is now becomes a much more complex problem, because you need to take the hook plate out and then you need to address that fracture. So how do I manage lateral and clavicle fracture? So I have a rule of 1.5 centimeter. This is arbitrary. At the moment, there's a cadaveric study going on under my supervision, which we are finalizing to let this rule come out. So this is 1.5 rule, which basically means that if you look at the most of the common lateral and clavicle plates that are available, all the locking screws on the lateral side are within 1.5 centimeter of the length of the plate, so both sides. And I've drawn a red line, which basically indicates that you at least get four plates. So this is a Zimmer Biomet plate, and this is an Acumet plate. So, and here you'll get five screws. So what I'm trying to see is how many screws I'm going to get. If it's a 2 centimeter, I'm very happy, because I know I'll get all five or all eight screws in, which gives me very stable fixation. But I start to worry when I see I can only get four screws or five screws in this side, because then I need to supplement it. So lateral and clavicle fracture, as we discussed, one is where you have a good strut of lateral bone, not much comminution, and you know what you can do. You can just put a plate on and that's about it. The second one is tricky, because you have comminution and there is CC ligament is gone, and then you need to supplement the fixation with some CC ligament stabilization. And the third one is even trickier, because there is a very little bone available, and you know that you will not be able to get more than one or two or three screws in this lateral fragment. And then what happens is that this will then start, one, it'll go into non-union, and then you have to remove this and then do a secondary procedure. So I personally don't like doing secondary procedures, so I just make up my plan that this is the best treatment for this patient and move ahead. So let's discuss, this is a case scenario one where there's a lateral and clavicle fracture more than 1.5 centimeter with no or minimal comminution. In this case, doesn't matter whatever you want to choose, depending on what is available, what has not been used last night, I just use one of these plates because I know that this will do me the work. These are all locking plates. So once you have five screws or eight screws in this one, you're pretty stable. What approach do I use? So I normally set them deck chair position. This is my arm positioner, and I quite like it because sometimes you don't have a senior registrar who can support you. So this arm positioner supports the shoulder while you're fixing and putting all the screws, as compared to the shoulder hanging down and displacing the fracture every time you try to put a screw in. And I use Tremano or whatever arm positioner for most of my surgeries. Approach, you can use a standard lateral clavicle plate, midline clavicle superior approach. More and often I'm using this brass trap incision because it heals very well. It's in the Langer lines and you can access, unless it's a long fracture, you can access most of the fracture with this. And it also gives you a very excellent view of the lateral and clavicle area. So this is one of the cases that we showed. So this is nicely been fixed. I put all the five screws in, four screws in this, and it went on to heal very, very well. This is another case where I used the other plate. Eight screws in medial side. I put only four screws because I didn't need another screw in, and we left it. So that's how I treat some patients who have a nice buttress of more than 2 centimeters on the lateral side that I know I'm confident I can fix it with a plate. Now comes a scenario where you have a lateral fracture with comminution, but the fragment is decent enough. And these again, because I know that I can get a full plate on with locking screws, I get a CT scan for some of these to just make sure that yes, I have enough bone to put four or five or eight screws in. And once I'm confirmed on CT scan, then I'll put the plate on. And as I said to you, this one, I need a little bit of support because there is comminution. All that stress of the arm is lying on that 4 or 5, 6, 7, 8 screws. So what I need to do is support that with a coracoclavicular reconstruction or a ligament repair. The ligament is already maybe gone. If it's gone, then we just do what we call an acucension. So this is a acumet plate. And this, if you ask for them, this is an acucension. So acucinch. So what it does is that you open it up and you can put this, it's like a rotator cuff anchor. You put it in the coracoid, make sure that you dissect it properly. And then you tie it inside that plate and there are holes for that to tie inside the plate. And once you've done that, you're pretty confident that you have some screws on this side, not all eight. And then you also have a secondary support for this fracture to heal. So this is a patient who had a lateral and clavicle fracture. When we got the CT, the fragment looked okay, but it was comminuted. So we put the acumet plate and put the acucinch in, and it healed very, very well. Now, the third scenario would be where the fragment is very small. And this is something sometimes people don't look at the x-rays properly and just get in and say, oh, yeah, that's fine. I'll just put a plate on. And when they expose it, the fragment is very small. And then it's tricky because you may not have all the armamentarium that you need. So I'm worried if I see a very small fragment or comminuted fragment, I always get a CT scan. And if the fragment is so small, I know that probably I'll get one or two screws in, which is then not useful. Now, I can use a hook plate, but I don't like hook plates. So the option for me is to use. So again, this is a patient who had very small bone available to us. So here, if you want a maximum, there's a fracture line there as well. So maximum, you'll get two screws in, which is not enough to hold a full clavicle fracture. So this was his fragment, which is so small that he probably would have got two screws. So this is zoomed up from my camera phone. So again, these will not be reconstructable in my hands. So what I do is I use a lockdown. This is an AC joint reconstruction, which I mentioned when I took the lecture last year. And it's all on the YouTube. And I think if you want, Hitesh can link it to you if you need. So this is a lockdown procedure, which helps me for my AC joint reconstruction. This is what I use for my AC joint reconstruction. So the interesting bit about it is that when you're doing the AC joint reconstruction in these, you have to take about 5 millimeters or 7 millimeters of bone away to avoid any AC joint impingement after the reconstruction. And this is the same, probably the same amount of bone that is lying here. So hence I started thinking, why not do a straight away and a lockdown for it. So now I've done about 11 or 12 of these. So I'll just show you what this means. And then you take a depth gauge and you measure, measure what it in, go behind the clavicle, put, reduce it, see what size of lockdown you need. And then what you can do is then put the lockdown in and again, go down behind the clavicle, bring it up. And this is where the tremolo is very useful, because then you can position the arm as you want, and it's fixed with a 3.5 screw. Now this is very, very stable, and normally they are in a sling for a couple of 3 to 4 weeks time, and I get them going straight out forward. They can go back to typing day-to-day desk jobs, answering phone calls within 3 to 4 weeks time, as compared to, in this case, it would be a small fracture. You're watching it for 6 to 8 weeks and you don't know whether it'll heal. So that all eliminates all that probabilities. So this is a case which I showed you, and this is what I did. So lockdown done for him. Joint is 7 millimeters or 5 millimeters. That bone fragment was removed. It's nicely leveled and he gets on with life. Another patient, if you see, this is a multiple pieces, and it's, in my hands, this would be unreconstructable. And then what I did was another lockdown, well reduced, get on with things. This is a patient who did not want initially surgery and had a lateral and clavicle fracture. It was 18 months to about 20 months by the time he came to me. And the plan from the surgeon he came to, was referred me, was that to fix it. And I thankfully got a CT scan. And if you look at the bone, it's very, very tiny. There's nothing to fix. So I had a chat with him and I did a lockdown for him, and he did very well. So again, the post-op regime for my lateral and clavicle fracture, which I think I fixed well, I get them in a sling for 2 to 3 weeks, and then they start, get an x-ray, make sure all is healing, and then get them going thereafter with physiotherapy. I see them back around 6 to 8 weeks time. If they all is well, they're discharged to physio. The ones that are, there's comminution and I put a acute cinch, I then see them again at 3 weeks, 6 weeks, and 12 weeks to make sure the fracture is healed, because some of these may move on to develop non-union. But most of these, if you fixed it well and also put some sort of CC ligament restraint, they generally heal very well. As compared to the lockdown, where I excise the lateral and clavicle fracture, then I put them in a sling for 2 to 3 weeks and then can get on with their sort of driving desk jobs at 3 weeks time. And most of them, although I tell them to not go into contact sports or heavy manual labor, at 6 to 8 weeks time, they'll return to normal function. So I've been very happy with this. I've done a lot of lockdowns over the last 10 years, and generally they do very, very well. So this is the first patient I showed you here, whom I did the lockdown. And this is him at 13 weeks. He works on the offshore in a heavy sort of a shipping yard. And if you see, he's got returned to full function, no pain. So thank you very much for listening. I hope I've shared with you what my thought processes are about managing lateral and clavicle fracture. I'm sure you will have the similar sort of algorithm in your heads, but I'm hoping you can take something back to this. This is my email address as somebody wants to coordinate, and otherwise you can email Hitesh and he can direct it to me. So thank you, Hitesh, for having me, and thank you all the audiences.
Thank you, Dr. Jariwala, for this brilliant presentation. A couple of questions from our side. Now, there is a trend for using suture techniques for the lateral and clavicle, assuming the fact that sometimes it's very comminuted and you can't put, a plate with screws. And also people have improved upon that. They've started putting suture anchors into the coracoid and looping around the distal fragment. So what is your take on that?
So one, we'll go to the suture anchor roping around the clavicle. Again, I understand I was giving a talk in West Bengal, and some of the units, they didn't have access to pre-contoured plates and they used hook plate, and that's fine. I'm not saying this is what is the only option. Hook plates have been around for years, and most of the people find that return back to most of the normal function. But again, we are in a new era. We shouldn't be going back in a shoulder surgery. We shouldn't be keeping patients with pain going on post-surgery as well. Now, suture anchor, I find if you're using just suture anchor, it's an emergency situation. Yes, it works, but again, you don't get that feel, and you're always guarding it. As regards the endo button or the tightrope fixation that people are doing, there are some cadaveric studies now which show that you possibly need two tightropes to be able to give very good mechanical strength to that clavicle to be able to get them going soon enough. And now I've also seen that if you start putting too tight ropes, the coracoid fractures. And that's a nightmare, because if your coracoid fractures and your AC joint is still not right, and due to fracture or AC joint dislocation, it's subluxated, what other options do you have? Very, very little. And then you're looking into doing some AC joint, AC ligament repair, or some sort of going into the anterior aspect of glenoid to fix it. So lockdown, as I said to you, Hitesh, before, sir, I've done about 50 plus lockdowns in the last 7 years, and I've been very happy with them. And if you see the patients, they're generally very, very happy. I'll give you an example. So there was a patient who had an AC joint dislocation, fixed him, and then he presented to A&E saying that he had shoulder pain, and he was referred to me next day in the clinic. And I saw him, I said, what happened? So this is about fourth day post-surgery. He still had the dressing on. And I said, what happened? He said, I fell off a truck. And I said, what do you mean you fell off a truck? He said, no, I was working, I fell off a truck. And I said, no, did I not tell you not to do anything for the first 3 weeks? He said, who's going to pay my bills? And I had no answer to that. So, but that just gave me the confidence as yes, it is no wonder that the patients return to full function and full activity around six to 8 week mark, which you will struggle to get it with either simple suture over the coracoid, under the coracoid and over the clavicle, or with single tightrope.
Thank you, Dr. Jariwala. We also joined by Dr. Loy Al-Khatib, who is an orthopedic surgeon and a shoulder specialist based in Dubai. Loy works at the Sulaiman Al-Habibi Hospital in Dubai. Loy, your questions to Dr. Jariwala, please.
Thanks a lot. It's an interesting talk. As I said before, this is a tricky situation. Always lateral clavicular fracture. Also, these are unique fractures, to be honest. And I like the way that you classified it, either displaced or undisplaced, and you didn't mention the near classification, which is, I'm not sure if this is what would be helpful nowadays to orient you or choose your fixation method. Anyway, one of the problems, I don't think there's a problem with the method that you choose to fix the lateral clavicle fracture. All of these fixation devices, hook plate, precontour plate, Ricoh plate, suspension devices, and so on, they will have a good healing rate. I think the problem lies in the complication rate. Complication, each technique or each fixation technique has its complications, such as using the suspensory fixation method, there'll be a risk of fistulizing, fracture of the coracoid, and so on. And a hook plate might cause impingement, rotator cuff irritation or rupture or osteolysis and so on. But to be honest, I have a very good experience with the hook plates. In Germany, we used to do only hook plates. 10, 15 years ago, they were used only hook plates. This is the old fashioned. And I can't remember, to be honest, to see any single complication after a hook plate. We used to see it, to take this hook plate after 4 months and the patient goes back to normal. Anyway, back in Germany, I used a couple of cases, maybe 15 cases in where I used to work in Klinikum Bad Hersfeld near Frankfurt. I implanted fixed 15 lateral lateral clavicle fracture using the tightrope. Three of these guys failed. Either they go back early to their activities, or they are bulky guys with the good muscles, and this suspensory ligament or suspensory fixation was not able to hold the fracture in itself. The problem that I sometimes face while I'm trying to fix this fracture is the posterior subluxation of the lateral fragment. Maybe you can give us a trick how to control this, the distal end or the lateral end of the clavicle fracture, and in order to achieve an anatomical reduction and fixation.
So I didn't. So the posterior subluxation of the lateral and clavicle fracture.
Yeah.
So I think again, what I normally do is that's why I've started using the brass trap incision, because that gives me complete access to the whole of the fragment. So I'll incise to the deltotrapezial fascia, and just before, I don't open the AC joint unless it's already ruptured, and which is uncommon in a fracture, lateral and clavicle fracture. So go on to the lateral and clavicle fracture. And then that is where the tremolo is very useful, because you can use and hold the arm in a position that you want, and it's anatomically reduced. Normally I use, if it's not a comminuted fracture, I'll use a toggle clip or a pointed reduction clamp. If I'm struggling, then I'll use K wires. And sometimes you need two K wires because they are comminution, so you need to hold it. And once you've held it, put the plate on, start from the lateral side first, fix that, and then put the plate on the medial, put the screws on the medial side.
Medial side. And do you have a number of screws that's at least three or four on the lateral side of the fracture? So that, because biomechanical studies showed that you need at least three bicortical screws. So if you end up with two, would you be happy with that, or would you augment your fixation, or how would you do that?
So this is what I was trying. That's a good question. This is what I sort of initially faced, because understanding, so these are not common fractures. And once they come in sort of in drones. So then you suddenly faced with it. So this is where, if I'm not sure, I'll 100% get a CT scan, because that gives you a good picture of how much bone is there. And once you get your CT scan, then you, again, it comes with experience. And once you've opened up and you've found yourself in difficulty, you learn from yourself. So fortunately, we have everything on the shelf, but my thought process is that at least I need four of the Zimmer plate and five of the Acumet plate. And if I'm there's any doubt on my head, I'll put a Accucension and double tie it, because again, it's a little bit costly, but a last thing I want is this patient back with the whole screws pulled off. So I've seen that as well. Some of my colleagues put three screws. First extra looks brilliant, and then you see, yeah, that's excellent. And then it suddenly it's pulled off. And then I got a phone call, Arpit, can you help me out?
That's true. So the message here, if you feel that the lateral fragment is too small, don't hesitate to order a CT scan. CT scan is really helpful in such a situation. It sounds weird, I know, ordering a CT for lateral cubic fracture, but this is totally uncommon fracture. And sometimes it's tricky, especially when you go to the operation room and you see, okay, this is a small, very small fragment, tiny fragment, there's no place for screws. So I think CT is very helpful in such conditions.
Dr. Jariwala, can I make a question?
Yes.
Yeah, like what you said, one of the issues that is inadequate purchase into the distal fragment, right? That is the main concern. And post-op, you find that everything is gone. So someone wants to know, if you put the plate even more laterally and get some screws into the acromion, so that you have purchase on the bone. Someone has asked that question.
No, that's true. And that's very tempting, because sometimes when you're in a soup where you think, just let's brush the AC joint. But I think that's a bad, that's a bad medicine. Because if I'm stuck in that position, and so thankfully in the last 5 years, I've never been in that position, because I always get a CT. And again, these are not urgent fractures. That they are not open forearm fractures, open fractures, or you have, it's not a compartment syndrome that you have to fix it in the middle of night or next day. So just plan it, get a CT scan, it gets it in a day, then you plan your surgery. But yes, as I said to you, if I go in and if I feel only there will be two screws that will be going in, then I'll just excise it and put a lockdown in. If I find that there is four or five screws, then I'll put the suspensory attachment. But I don't think it's not a good medicine to go over the acromion, because that's putting like K wires, or used to put, I've not put myself, but you see all these textbooks when you read AC joint injuries, you'll see all these K wires and screws growing through the acromion into the lateral and clavicle. And again, you know where the K wires finally end in the area of love, which is heart.
No, it's only the plate. The plate is slid slightly laterally and screws into the acromion. The reason I'm asking is, does it, it's like a fusion of the AC joint, right? You're automatically fusing the AC joint. So does it have a long-term implication?
You'll not be able to move. So you remember that that the clavicle rotates with your shoulder movements. So the moment you start taking above 90 degrees, you'll not be able to move. And the very first thing will happen, will start osteolysis of the acromion or an acromial fracture. And I wish that nobody sees an acromial fracture, because it is a nightmare to deal with.
Great. Dr. Al-Khatib, any more questions from your side?
Not really. Maybe one comment is too many techniques, to be honest. Like the CC screw, I think it's out of date now. The lockdown technique that we're talking about is similar to last technique they're using, synthetic graft, and they fold it around the coracoid, and on top they're fixing it to the two limbs will be fixed with the interferon screw. I think it would be the same, similar technique, same results. Good topic. Thanks a lot. Covered a lot of important issues. Again, this is not a common fracture. And keep in mind, doing a CTE, if you have healed that lateral end is so small and won't accept two more than three screws.
Okay, Loy, I think that's all the questions that we have. Dr. Jariwala, thank you so much for this brilliant presentation. That's all the questions that we have for this session. Thank you once again for joining.
Thanks a lot, Mahitesh. Thanks, Loyal.
Thanks. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Cheers. Recording.